Gonzalez. Commissioner Cavallaro is also the country rapporteur for Guyana. As I am, of course, Commissioner Rosemary Antoine, the president. As always, we will give you each 20 minutes to make your presentations, and we will start with the petitioners. Thank you.
Thank you, distinguished Chair, Professor Rosemary Antoine, and other esteemed commissioners, Honorable Minister Caroline Rodriguez Burkett, Honorable Ambassador Beni Karan, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon, and thank you for this opportunity for dialogue on discrimination in the enjoyment of economic, social, and cultural rights in Guyana. My name is Shamel Patrick, and I'm the Advocacy and Communications Officer at the Society Against Sexual Orientation Discrimination. We are a delegation of four organizations representing the Guyana Equality Forum, which is a network of civil society organizations working for equal rights and justice for all Guyanese. The petitioners include, and I'll introduce my colleagues based in the order which will be presenting this afternoon. To my right is Imara Radex, and she is the executive director of the Sisterhood of Support, Services, and Sustainability, also known as the S4 Foundation, and she will be presenting specifically on the gender equality and violence and its impact on the socio-economic life of women and girls. To her right is Colin Culkey. He is the chief of the Guyanese Association of Indigenous Peoples, and he is going to be sharing on human trafficking, trafficking in persons, and cultural genocide. To his right is Sabine McIntosh. She is the director of Deaf Association of Guyana, and she'll be speaking to the issue of the right to language and education for deaf persons. And finally, Joel Simpson. He is the managing director of the Society Against Sexual Orientation Discrimination. And to start our presentation, I'll hand over to Imara.
Thank you. Good evening, distinguished commissioners, our esteemed honorable minister, Caroline Rodriguez Burkett, Ambassador Beni Karan, good evening. The Guyana Constitution states that women and men have equal rights and the same legal status in all spheres of life in Guyana. Today, I will share evidence utilizing public news reports and reports of cases made to the S4 Foundation that show we have a long way to go in spite of the far-reaching legislation in Guyana for women and girls. These would be the Domestic Violence Act of 1996, the Sexual Offenses Act of 2010, and the Prevention of Discrimination Act of 1997. Women and girls continue to suffer in all spheres of Guyana, from maternity deaths, domestic violence, teenage pregnancy, trafficking in persons, rape and murder of elderly women, sexual harassment in the workplace, and discrimination due to HIV status or gender status in the workplace. These issues continue to disproportionately affect the women and girls in Guyana in terms of their economic, social, and cultural rights. Guyana remains in the top five in the Caribbean and the Americas for the highest maternal mortality rate. We have the second highest rate of teenage pregnancy in the Caribbean and the highest rate of teenage suicide. The S4 Foundation has reports on record of women not knowing their rights. But one of the major issues is that women are not economically empowered to be able to afford the legal services to fight their cases. They continue to be severely affected by the stigma associated with being raped and/or being HIV positive. This affects their willingness to access healthcare services, medical attention, and legal advice. In a local media report dated March 9, 2015, Elizabeth Zechmeister of the Latin American Public Opinion Project commented on a recent set of surveys from 2006 to 2014, conducted with thousands of Guyanese. She said the responses of the survey indicated a high level of acceptance of domestic violence when compared to the Americas. The data shows that Guyana was ranked third with 35.6% in interviewed countries on acceptance of domestic violence. El Salvador is at 42.1% and Guatemala is ranked highest at 58%. Margaret Kirsch's coordinator of one of the Guyana Equality Forum's partner organizations, Help and Shelter, said domestic violence is perceived to be a normal activity in the Guyanese culture. This is a key obstacle in the enjoyment of economic, social, and cultural rights for women. She noted that persons were constantly seen fighting, even on the street, and she deemed the society an abusive one. Women are psychologically affected. They're disempowered. They have their confidence stripped and their education stopped. S4 has received monthly direct reports that of persons who are beaten that go to the police, and they would be told, as Margaret Kirsch says in this same news report, that they deserve the licks. Further, she states, it is a norm in our society that men can go out and be unfaithful, but women cannot do the same and not be beaten for it. News reports in the Guyana Times, dated July 23, 2013. The Human Rights Report on Guyana, done by the US government, says that domestic violence and violence against women, including spousal abuse, was widespread. It crosses both racial and socioeconomic lines. Court records from 2013 show 279 cases filed and only 143 persons were convicted. Dr. Vivian Mitchell, consultant anesthetist attached to the Georgetown Public Hospital Corporation, said that it is believed that two-thirds of women suffer from domestic violence and they are attended to by healthcare officials. However, this figure could represent a significant shortfall in the actual number of cases reported. S4 has received reports of the fear of reporting due to the abuser having contacts in the police force. There are threats of intimidation, shame, and lack of faith in the justice system. There are also bribes for the police. This, combined with lack of data and proper record keeping, means we cannot track the prevalence rates, but the violence is severely unreported. Based on this information, S4 recommends that the state give specialized ongoing procedural and sensitivity training to the police for dealing with survivors of violence. The government should consider creating a program to hire and train counselors in ministries and in schools that will protect the confidentiality of children and women. The Child Protection Act and the National Child Care and Protection Policy must be strengthened to address LGBT children whose needs are not being met. We have additionally received reports of girls being transported in trucks, stopped at police checkpoints, taken into police stations for sexual services to the police. They are put back in the trucks and the trucks are sent on. We would be happy to work with the government to create sustainable spaces across the country for women and girls who are homeless and abused, where they can get access to food, they can get access to clothing, counseling, education, and medical care, as well as psychological treatment. Finally, national education programs should be created and implemented by the government in schools in partnership with civil society. I thank you.
Good day, everyone. Good night, I should say. I'll start. One issue of grave concern to the GOIP and other civil society groups in Guyana is the trafficking of indigenous girls and women, particularly those in the 15 to 30 age bracket. These girls' human rights are repeatedly violated when they are forced lured or conned into high-paying jobs, most notably to some gold mining camps of Region 7, 8, and 1. Others are trafficked to provide all kinds of services for businesses such as liquor restaurants in the highly populated coastal belt. One indigenous girl trafficked is one too much. Some of this TIP trade is also cross-border, Guyana, Venezuela, Brazil, and Suriname. There's also evidence to suggest discrimination against indigenous girls in the form of ethnic profiling that has indigenous girls as prime targets for the sexual lusts of gold miners. One solution to this scourge must be the provision by Guyana's authorities of resources to have young indigenous girls trained in self-defense and anti-rape martial arts techniques. Also, Guyana's authorities must work with relevant civil society groups to address this issue. Indigenous Guyanese continue to be at the receiving end of forms of cultural genocide, especially in areas such as the loss of traditional languages. In this regard, the Carib, Waro, and Lokono languages continue to be threatened with extinction. Guyana's authorities must provide resources to save these languages and also perhaps add these languages to the curriculum of the schools in respective indigenous areas. Indigenous Guyanese continue to experience very low self-esteem as a result of constant ethnic abuse by other ethnicities. This is an assault on a people's social and cultural integrity. The slur Bok people or Bokan people is often used to denigrate this already very vulnerable segment of society. Guyana's authorities need to put systems in place to stop this stereotyping of its first peoples. The Ethnic Relations Commission, ERC, needs to be strengthened to further deal with this issue. However, already some GOIP members have been responding to such attacks with the words, "Thanks for complimenting me on my ability to run fast." In other words, they're educating people as to the origin of the word Bok. It was used by the Dutch colonizers to describe the very fast running or sprinting ability of our first peoples. In closing, Guyana's authorities are signatories to conventions that safeguard against discrimination in the areas of economic, cultural, and social rights of all its citizens, including vulnerable groups, which includes its first peoples. The GYP and other advocacy groups will continue to ensure such agreements are honored in future years. Thank you very much.
Good evening. Universally, the writer language is inalienable. Sign language, then, the first language of the deaf, is the inalienable right. I would like to show in this presentation how our disrespect for this right is largely responsible for the extent to which we are failing the deaf community. Over 90% of deaf children are born into hearing families and are therefore deprived of early language development, which we know is a crucial stage in child development. There is need then for this and other reasons for early intervention for every deaf child. Unhappily, the lack of data on the incidence of deafness in Guyana is a major setback in this respect. For example, as of January 2015 in Region 9, neither the regional health officer nor the regional education officer had on record any deaf person in their region. Nursery and primary years are the time when children develop their identity and establish their values. Through academic achievement and involvement in social and cultural activities. How does this work for deaf children? In Guyana, deaf children are educated in 4 public special needs schools, which they share with intellectually impaired children. The only exception being the Tushin Deaf Academy, a small but budding deaf-only school, which was established by our association 2 years ago. From our observation, which is extensive and ongoing, special needs schools are not provided the necessary resources, the necessary special resources to meet these special needs, which for the deaf would include, first and foremost, the teaching in and of sign language. Unhappily, at present, there is no official sign language program for teachers of the deaf. neither is there a requirement for them to be educated in sign language. Neither is there a program for interested deaf persons to become teachers of the deaf. And we know, as a matter of fact, and as well documented, that deaf teachers are the best teachers for the deaf. Of course, there's also a need for appropriate materials and equipment and for the application of deaf education methodology. These serious shortcomings in the education of the deaf in Guyana must be held responsible for the dismally low level in English literacy, English being the deaf students' secondary language, as well as the other core subjects in primary school. In the wider hearing community, this poor level of education reinforces the widely held belief, even among the family members of the deaf, that deaf persons are not only deaf, but also dumb. There's evidence galore that this is not so, but that the educational level of school leavers is in direct relation to the quality of teaching throughout their school years and indeed during their preschool years. Further, and this is zooming in on the economic aspect, the above is a severe hindrance in deaf youth's efforts to access vocational training and employment. And this is an ongoing painful issue for our association as we seek to respond to the many requests for help in this respect. The Deaf Association of Guyana, a registered non-governmental organization and an associate member of the World Federation of the Deaf, has since its inception in 2008 successfully initiated and maintained a wide range of programs and activities in support of deaf development in and out of schools. I wish to end by stating on behalf of the Deaf Association of Guyana that we are anxiously seeking a more intensive partnership with the state beyond our present level of collaboration in order to move effectively to establish equality for the deaf. Thank you.
Distinguished commissioners, honorable representatives of the state, it's an indisputable fact that the state of Guyana discriminates against lesbian, bisexual, and transgender people in law and policy. In law, sections 351 to 353 of the Criminal Law Offences Act, chapter 8:01, criminalize same-sex intimacy between consenting adult men in private. Cross-dressing is also criminalized in another colonial era provision under section 153, section 1, subsection 47 of the Summary Jurisdiction Act, Chapter 8:02. Guyana unofficially and actively enforces these inherently discriminatory laws. In May 2006 and February 2009, there were prosecutions for cross-dressing. After a two-day crackdown in February 2009, when at least seven persons were arrested, detained, and fined for cross-dressing, three of the victims and SASOD filed a constitutional suit a year later in February 2010. In September 2013, Acting Chief Justice Ian Chang, sitting as the Constitutional Court, ruled that cross-dressing is not a crime unless it's for an improper purpose. The litigants are appealing the exception made for improper purpose, as we believe it is vague, uncertain in scope, overly subjective, and practically meaningless. Even after this partial decriminalization by the court since September 2013, the state has taken no real concrete steps to expound these odious provisions from the law books in Guyana. Police extortion of men who appear to be gay and bisexual continues unabated. SASA documents several cases every year, but social stigma against homosexuality is so strong that complainants are reluctant to test existing redress mechanisms like the Police Complaints Authority and the Police Service Commission. The stigma of homosexuality is in the allegation itself, and these discriminatory laws confer a status of unapprehended criminals on us as LGBT people for simply being who we are. These insidious laws and the everyday societal discrimination we face have a profound impact on our economic, social, and cultural life as LGBT people in Guyana. Today, I would like to focus on one basic economic right, the right to work. Anti-LGBT discrimination is rampant in the labor market in Guyana, both in the public and private sector. A qualified transgender woman from Berbice reported being mocked and ridiculed at an interview at the Ministry of Home Affairs after being shortlisted for the post of forensic support officer in April 2013. SASAD has documented several cases of homophobic and transphobic discrimination in the private sector, far too many to mention in this brief hearing. Though in denial, the state party is well aware of these reports, having responded to SASAD's report at Guyana's Universal Periodic Review session in Geneva in January of this year. While Guyana has good legislation to protect people from discrimination in employment, recruitment, training, and membership of professional bodies, through the Prevention of Discrimination Act 1997, LGBT people are not offered any legal protection by this legislation. Section 4.2 of the 1997 Act lists the grounds of protection as race, sex, religion, color, ethnic origin, indigenous population, national extraction, social origin, economic status, political opinion, disability, family responsibilities, pregnancy, marital status, and age, except for the purposes of retirement and restrictions on work and employment of minors, and any characteristics which appertain generally or are generally impacted to persons of these characteristics. By a simple amendment to Section 4.2 to include just four words, sexual orientation, gender identity, the 1997 Act would extend protection to LGBT people, like the Barbadian transgender woman who experienced discrimination in recruitment by the Ministry of Home Affairs in April 2013. I conclude by reiterating what we already know, that the state has a duty to respect, protect, and fulfill human rights for all its citizens. The state violates human rights when it has discriminatory laws on its books and actively enforces them. The state also fails in its responsibility to protect citizens from discrimination by not including sexual orientation and gender identity in the Prevention of Discrimination Act 1997. Distinguished commissioners, honorable representatives of the state, on behalf of the Guyana Equality Forum, I extend sincere gratitude for this opportunity, for this dialogue on discrimination in the enjoyment of economic, social, and cultural rights in Guyana, as we work to improve human rights protection of all peoples in Guyana and the rest of the American hemisphere. Thank you.
Honorable Minister Rodriguez Burkett.
Commissioners James Cavallaro and Felipe Gonzalez, staff of the Secretariat, members of the NGO community from Guyana, presenting this evening, ladies and gentlemen all. The government of Guyana is very pleased to be participating in this hearing. However, I must indicate that had we been provided with the information beforehand, the detailed information that was presented to us this afternoon, we would have been in a better position to respond in more detail. I would respond to some of the issues that were raised as far as I can do right now, but I would certainly be in a position to provide additional information to the Commission on some of the issues raised. I would like to begin by responding to some of the issues raised by Ms. Imara from the S4 Foundation. And the government of Guyana, I would say, shares your view that we have to do more for women and girls in our country, and I think women and girls in the Caribbean and across the world. In terms of the maternal deaths, I would definitely agree that we have to work to getting to zero. We must look at the situation at this point in time, though, in terms of context, where we were and where we are. And we have been able to reduce maternal deaths significantly. We have been able to increase the number of trained health professionals tending to maternal cases by a large percent, and I'll be able to provide the detailed percentages to the commissioner in commission in writing. But yes, one debt is too much, and it grieves the heart of most of us that are of all of us that are mothers, I would say, but as the society as a whole. On the issue of domestic violence, I think that while it might I might sound a bit anecdotal, it would not be far-fetched to say that domestic violence, I think, is probably more being more reported today than before because of the information, social media, and the access that we have now to the media. But some would want to also say that there appears to be an increase of domestic violence. I was looking at the figures that we presented to the UNUPR. In 2011, we had 5,692 reported cases of domestic violence, and 1,918 persons were charged. In 2013, we had a drop in the reports to 2,644, and 1,640 persons were charged. One would want to say then that some of the educational activities that we have had in Guyana, not only by the government or by the state, but also by NGOs and so on, would have had some impact, some positive impact in this regard. Yet, however, we do see in our media the reported cases of domestic violence, and I would say that we have to continue with our communication strategy on this issue. This is not just an issue for the government to deal with. It's we have to put in place the resources and the mechanisms. But as was mentioned too, some of these things are deeply cultural. And in some cases, we have heard of even women themselves saying that I deserved this particular kind of treatment because I did this and I did that. And so we have to work more, I think, with our women. I'm not saying that men are not victims of domestic violence, but I think by and large it's women. And we have to work more to build self-esteem, to build confidence, to put other measures in place. But a lot has been done. We have been training, and you speak, Ms. Imara, about training of police officers, and we've done quite a lot of training. But I would be the first to agree that training has to be ongoing, and we will continue to have training, and perhaps we can partner in this respect, because I am well aware that while we might be receiving reports at the level of the state as an NGO, you might also have other information that together we can put in place these other measures in addition to the ones that we all already have. In terms of the health care services for domestic violence victims, I think health care, at least in the public sector, is free. And we have been working with our healthcare workers to identify domestic violence cases, because there are times when people might come in, when women might come in with an injury, but they would say they had a fall and not necessarily report that this is as a result of a domestic violence case. And so we have been as well working with our healthcare professionals in this regard. Now, you mentioned something that that made me worry, where I've written it down here. Women are beaten and are being told, I think I heard by the police, but I'm not sure, that they deserve the licks. Now, if that's the case, then I would certainly like that information to be provided to the state, because we need to investigate that, which police station this occurred, who are the policemen, because I'm sure the person who or the persons would be able to identify those policemen. What has been reported to me in a few cases, because I myself had at least on one occasion to call the police about a case that was reported to me, and they faithfully called me back the evening to say that the woman said she does not want to press any charges, she does not want to give them any information. So they also face some challenges in terms of dealing with these cases, but I agree it is a partnership that we have to develop. The abuser being in contact with the police force, again, if you have that information, I can rest assured that we would be able to keep this in confidence if you provide that kind of information so that we could deal with the cases of police abusing their power. And your recommendation for training, of course, like I said, it's ongoing and we have to do more in that regard. And yes. I would also like to request the specifics on girls in trucks providing sexual favors to the police and being returned to the truck. I am not aware of this, but if you have that information, again, we really would like to have this because we want to make sure that our image as a government and as a country is constantly improved on matters like this, and we would like to deal with these cases if indeed these things are occurring. I would now refer to the issues that were raised by Mr. Colin Clowkey of the Ghana Organization of Indigenous Peoples and Trafficking in Persons. The very nature of trafficking it sometimes wouldn't allow you to have the kind of data you would like to have on this. And we have a task force with several different agencies involved. Even the Ministry of Foreign Affairs is on that task force, where we work with the Ministry of Home Affairs, Human Services, and Ministry of Amerindian Affairs, and so on. And we have a mechanism in place to investigate cases of trafficking in persons. I probably would have to agree with you, Mr. Clowkey, that because of the geography of our indigenous communities being further in the remote areas, mostly inaccessible, but closer to probably the mining areas, our indigenous women perhaps would be more vulnerable in that respect. And so again, I would like if the GOIP can work with us, if you have, because you are very specific in the age group. And so I would imagine that you have more information on these cases so that you can provide us to us. Commissioners, I'm from an indigenous community, and so you would appreciate my bias as well in terms of any case of trafficking in those areas. Well, any case at all, but in those areas more so because of the access to information and so on, we would like to have those investigated. The ethnic profiling on indigenous persons, I think that we have come a far way in Guyana in terms of our unity as a people. And the fact that we now have a Ministry of Amerindian Affairs dealing with indigenous peoples' issues, we have a commission on indigenous peoples, a constitutional commission on indigenous peoples, with indigenous peoples on that commission, along with the fact that indigenous peoples are also represented on the Ethnic Relations Commission and on some of the other commissions, and this is in law, I think we have come a far way. We have to utilize those commissions, and I think it would be good in this very way that we've come before the ISCHR, that these kinds of reports and these kinds of issues should also be brought to the commission's attention back home, all of the commissions, so that they would be able to investigate it. They have resources from the national budget as well. I'm not sure about the martial arts technique training our girls to ward off would-be rapists. I'm not sure about that. I think what we have to do is train all our people, all our boys and men and women, that rape is zero tolerance for rape, and that must not even, there mustn't even be an approach in that respect. But I think our population is more aware of the of that rape is wrong. And more reports, I think, are being made. But let me also say that I am disappointed, and the government of Ghana is disappointed with the low rate of convictions in terms of reported rape cases. And we have said that as well to the UPR. So, and of course, I'm sure that the judiciary would have heard us loud and clear. Cultural genocide and the languages. I'm from the Arawak tribe, and I cannot speak Arawak. And when I go to other parts of my country and listen to my brothers and sisters speaking in their indigenous languages, I certainly feel a little bit less of a person as well. And this is why we have the government of Guyana. We recognize that certain languages, the ones you mentioned, Carib, Warao, and Lokono, these languages are becoming extinct, mostly Lokono. And we've started some programs. In fact, we just reprinted the Arawak dictionary, the Wapishana dictionary as well. And we have started some programs in the Rupununi of teaching the language, but I'm also aware of the Ministry of Amerindian Indian Affairs being involved in several other language programs. And so this, I think, Mr. Clowkey, is an opportunity as well for GOIP to probably work with the ministry on the language program. As you know, we have just had the national anthem of our country in translated in some of the languages, the national pledge as well. So those things are things that we've begun with. Introducing it in the curriculum, we have had some discussions on this. When you have 9 different languages, which one you're going to introduce into the curriculum, that would become an issue. But we also have to ensure that we know very clearly the phonetics and so on, because there's a view that in one part the language, these are the words, and in another part there's some modifications. And so I think for beginners, what we're doing is it's good, but we would like to work with you in that respect as well. The abuse by other ethnicities on indigenous peoples. Again, I think that we have we've come a far way in this respect in terms of indigenous peoples and their place in the Guyanese society. Immodest as this may sound, I'm the Minister of Foreign Affairs of my country, and I'm an indigenous person. So we have, of the female MPs in our parliament, 23% of them are indigenous women. And these are we're 10% of the population. Indigenous people are 10% of the population, and having that percentage of female members of parliament, I think it's very, very significant. And but that's that's one area. I think that the things that we have been doing, and perhaps one day, commissioners, you might be able to visit Guyana during Amerindian Heritage Month, where we have quite a lot of activities to recognize the contributions, the challenges, and so on as well for our indigenous population. And during that entire month, Guyanese of all walks of life participate in those activities. And so I think there is an awareness and a reduction of discrimination by others. But yes, I'm sure that there will be times when you're going to be called, you might be called names. I think what we have to work on is to ensure that we build the high self-esteem of our people, that you could be called whatever people call you, but you're able to deal with it in a manner that they themselves might not want to do that again. But I, in my own view, we have seen quite an improvement. How do you stop stereotyping? I think it's through education. It's through education. And I am, very pleased that now, unlike, let's say, 15 years ago or so, most of our indigenous children had no access to secondary education. And so we have had a program to ensure that there's access to secondary education. Just about 15 years ago, in the entire Guyana, we had one indigenous doctor, one. Now, today, with the assistance of Cuba, we have hundreds of Guyanese doctors that have been trained in Cuba, but many of them are also indigenous people. And so I think that there's been a great improvement in education, and that helps with the with reducing those stereotypes, because if you're going to have indigenous peoples in the different workplaces in the city, for example, in the military, in the ministries, in the private sector, and I think that's pretty visible now than probably when I moved to Georgetown 22 years ago. And so I think you have more people that are in the different in the different sectors. Ms. Sabine, let me say here that I want to congratulate you on the work that you have been doing with the deaf community in Guyana, and I know that your heart and soul is in the are in the work that you do. In terms of the training, we would definitely like to provide training in sign language. We have cooperation with several countries that have done well in this respect. And let us talk. We would certainly be able to do this. I think some of the volunteers that we've had coming in specialize in training in this area, but we would like to work with you. And on the database of deaf persons, this is something I think we can do almost immediately. So I would take this back and probably set up a meeting that we can meet with the relevant minister so that we can continue this work. Because I agree with you that this is one aspect that perhaps we haven't paid too much attention to that we must pay attention to. But we're also building a center for persons with disabilities. And it's not only for Guyana, but for the Caribbean, but it's going to be based in Guyana. And perhaps this is one aspect that your technical expertise we can draw on in this area. But I cannot agree more with you, and we should be working with you on resources and all of that. So thank you for bringing the deaf community issues here. I would finally like to refer to the issues raised by Joel. And Joel, I've noted the passion in which you've made your presentation. And some of these things are deeply rooted in religious and cultural beliefs. And one of the things we did, because we realized that if you're going to decriminalize same-sex intimacy, what is on our books, we have to make sure that we get the people who would have to pass the laws, which would be the parliamentarians involved in this. And this is why the state took a motion to establish a select committee of the parliament to deal with this issue, so that we can, and corporal punishment and capital punishment as well, but so that we would be able to have hearings with the Guyanese population and be able to come back to parliament with a recommendation. I'm on that select committee. And we've started with corporal punishment, and certainly we would be dealing with the LGBT issue as well. But perhaps too, this is because as a member of the select committee and as a member of the state, you've been trying to get the views of different groups on this issue, which is a very difficult one for some persons. But I think. And I think that we are, the fact that we're discussing it in our country, let's say opposed to 5 years ago, I remember when we first presented our first UPR, you hadn't that kind of discussion on this issue. But I think that we have more discussions on it, and I think that we can probably, work on educating our people more. But at the end of the day, it would be a political decision in the parliament. Because parties would have to vote on this matter. So a lot of it would also have to do with educating our people in Parliament. Now, Parliament has been dissolved, but I can assure you that we are going to bring back this matter to the Parliament as soon as Parliament resumes for a select committee to continue its work in this area. But if we can educate our people more, perhaps we would have... We would be able to make some changes. On the issue of the cross dressing, again, this is the separation of powers here. But to say that the state has taken no action on these issues, I would have to disagree, because like I mentioned, we've set up the select committee on the LGBT issue. On the cross-dressing issue, we're aware of that appeal, and we'll see how that would work. I this is the first time for me hearing about this issue of the Barbican transgender person that was mocked at the allegedly as the Ministry of Home Affairs. I would like to have more information on this, and certainly would like to have this matter investigated, because I'm aware of many persons that are LGBT in the public sector, we don't discriminate in terms of our employment. The private sector, of course, I'm not sure that we have widespread discrimination in the private sector. But I think if you have these cases, and this one, because you allegedly said it took place in a state institution, the Ministry of Home Affairs, this is one that we would certainly need to investigate. My time is up. Huh? Sorry. Let me conclude.
Thanks. Okay. Thank you. I actually gave both of you an extra minute. Both sides.
Thank you.
Okay. So may I ask Commissioner Caballero, the rapporteur for Guyana, to speak? Thank you.
So my thanks to all the representatives of civil society for the information, for raising this issue, for coming here. My thanks as well to the minister, to the ambassador. As my colleague has noted, it's clearly a sign of the importance that you give to the topic in this body, that you have such a high level delegation. I had a series of notes of questions that I was going to raise, and they were all related to requests that the representatives of civil society made to open a dialogue and to work more closely with the state on a range of issues. And I've successively been crossing out each one as you expressed your interest and your willingness on behalf of the state to return to Georgetown and to meet with S4 and discuss the issues involving women and girls in situation of risk, on issues of trafficking, on issues of the Ethnic Relations Committee, of partnering on promoting deaf education. And I think that's probably the best thing that this sort of forum and the hearings that the commission can provide is a space to bring civil society together with state authorities to raise issues of concern in human rights and to seek solutions. So rather than a question, my only comment based on what I see is an effort to promote dialogue on return to Georgetown and to see how to each of these specific questions that have been raised may be addressed. I would just say that I had the distinct pleasure to visit Georgetown a few years ago when I was a candidate. And as country rapporteur, I would be happy to return if my presence or with a team of from the commission, one or two staff attorneys, if that would be useful in terms of identifying best practices in other parts of the world, in other parts of the Americas, on the issues that have been raised today, I would be happy to do it. Madam Minister, you raised a particular time when it would be particularly valuable culturally to visit Guyana. I welcome that opportunity, and so I would just like to express my interest as country rapporteur on behalf of the commission to return to Guyana. And again, my thanks, and I will leave questions to the President and my colleague.
Commissioner Gonzalez.
Thank you, Madam President. Very short because of time. Well, I also had the opportunity to visit Guyana, but not seeking votes as my colleague Commissioner Cavallaro, but as part of an international mission to investigate the assassination of Mr. Walter Rodney. That was exactly 20 years ago when I went there in March 95. And there are many important issues that have been raised here. I just wanted to make a mention about the sexual rights of the LGBTI persons, which not long ago was an issue really in Latin America as well, and it was a crime according to a penal code in most countries of Latin America, and this seemed to be in Latin America an intractable problem. But in fact, once the the crime was abolished from the books, it never came back again, really. I mean, there wasn't any discussion to reinstate this in the books. Of course, there are some countries in Latin America, to be sure, where homophobia is extended still, but the issue of deleting this from the books really contributed to establish a certain level and it also takes out one factor for the police to extortion LGBT persons, for instance. Thanks.
I wanted to start with the right to work, which was specifically raised in relation to LGBTI rights. And I wanted to ask that despite the existence of what we all agree are discriminatory laws in Guyana and in several other countries in the region, I might add, in CARICOM region, that is, whether there's any mechanism to collect data for persons who have been discriminated against at the workplace, trying to access work, and their rights to work violated, and if not, if the state is willing to try to collect data in some, even if it's in an anonymous way, because we understand the discrimination, I think that would be valuable as a tool. And of course, I must ask, is Guyana willing to go the extra step to add the ground of sexual orientation to the anti-discrimination laws? You talked about your committee and so on, but it seems to be a broad committee, not specifically on that. And to say that St. Lucia recently, which is a Catholic country, did in fact add sexual orientation to its equality of opportunity legislation, it more or less went unnoticed. Nobody made a fuss. Really and truly, which is different from when you start that debate about whether you should decriminalize sodomy laws, and that's, you know, gets very emotional. But one thing I've noticed in my own work in the region, that people who say with one breath, no, we should not because of religion or culture and so on, we don't want to abolish the laws, in the same breath they say we shouldn't discriminate. I can never quite understand the contradiction, but it actually is something that a UNAIDS study recently in Trinidad found, that over 70% of people said we shouldn't discriminate on the grounds of LGBTI. So I think what it does require is moral leadership and fortitude, and perhaps it's not as big a deal as we think it is, and we can move forward in that relationship and ensure that persons at least have the right to work, and I'm sure the right to be educated too, because there would be discrimination also in the schools if there's discrimination at the workplace. I was also, and there were many, many issues that were raised. We don't have time to go into all of them. And I just want to say we'll have some things, ask you for things in writing as well. But in relation to the trafficking, that is also something that concerns me deeply, particularly as it relates to Indigenous peoples, and I'm the rapporteur for Indigenous peoples. And to ask, yes, there's a task force, but are there any clear routes to enforcing the law? How does Guyana, we all have these wonderful trafficking laws now, but how does Guyana go about attempting to enforce those trafficking laws? Because it is, again, conceded that it is a problem. One would normally have extra policing, but I can see that policing might be quite problematic in the interior with Indigenous peoples. You don't want to have a heavy police presence, I would imagine, in the interior. And this is why perhaps the suggestion by the Indigenous peoples themselves, they are saying that they want to be empowered. They want to have training in martial arts. I don't think it's something that it might be innovative, but perhaps it's something we should take seriously, because it seems to me it's part of the right to self-determination in terms of, and being self-sufficient in taking care of yourselves, which is, and of course self-determination is something that Indigenous peoples have fought for and won. And clearly trafficking is not just about rape. Trafficking is much broader than rape. It's about displacement. It's about freedom of movement and other forms of violence. So I see that as something that perhaps there are concrete steps now that we can take, working with Indigenous peoples to help with that particular issue. And also to say, to ask, what mechanisms does Guyana have in place in relation to trafficking, which is cross-border, which is a huge issue in Guyana? How is your task force, or are you having dialogue with other countries to sort of identify Guyanese citizens who have been trafficked elsewhere, and how do they return back to Guyana? Things like that. How they return to Guyana? These are the kinds of issues in terms of that I would want to be able to interrogate clearly. The issue of language is also one which, when we start talking about economic, social, and cultural rights, both in terms of persons with disabilities and in terms of indigenous peoples, again, I think is really, really important. Indigenous peoples, again, establish rights to cultural identity. In some countries, we have special schools established for indigenous peoples to ensure that their cultural heritage is preserved. And also, just generally, the impact of the right to education, which clearly impacts your livelihood. And I acknowledge, Honorable Minister, and you are living testimony, the strides that have been made in relation to that. But Guyana has one of the most important indigenous populations in the region, and there's still obviously more to do and more that can be done in partnership with indigenous peoples themselves. So I think that is concerning. Disability is something in the same vein about language and so on that the commission recently has been re-emphasizing. We had the first convention, but now there's a UN convention. So it's become a really big topic for us. And it's clear that inclusion is one of the things that we know a modern approach to persons living with disabilities. I was surprised to hear that you still have the sort of the old-fashioned schools where just people with disabilities live together, and it seems, you know, it's really not the way that we go now in order to ensure that persons who have disabilities have their right or can enjoy their rights to education and work. So we can have 3 minutes each to respond. We understand that you can't speak to all of the issues or the questions, and we would appreciate having them in writing, but we'll still give each of you 3 minutes further.
Thank you, commissioners and honorable representatives of the states. Just briefly to respond on the LGBT issues, I'm glad that Minister Rodrigues Burkett is here, because one of the things that falls directly under your purview as with the foreign affairs portfolio is the annual sexual orientation gender identity resolution. And I would like to express my regret that for the last 2 years in particular, Guyana has been footnoting its non-commitment of sorts to that annual resolution, which we've been signing on to since 2008. And I think those are backward steps which fall directly under your portfolio, that we need to address if we're serious about having dialogue and moving forward. Since 2008, we've had a resolution at the General Assembly every year, progressively seeking to improve protection for LGBT issues. And now Guyana and a few other Caribbean states are no longer committing to that consensus resolution by footnoting its non-commitment, which I think is grave concern and really, really taking us steps back. In terms of the issues of legislation, like you mentioned, I agree with Madam President Bel-Antoine that the issues around the Prevention of Discrimination Act 1997, and just adding those four words, are really the legislative low-hanging fruit. They would pass without a fuss, because even the survey data that we have in Guyana shows that people oppose discrimination widely on the basis of sexual orientation and gender identity. It's the decriminalization which causes a great deal of fuss. So I want to challenge the state, at the very least, to just add those four words to the legislation to provide protection for people. It's a simple amendment, it's one page. I could draft it myself to assist the state in this regard. On the issue of the April 2013 incident at the Ministry of Home Affairs, we're happy to bring that case to you. The person is actively involved in our organization. So one of the immediate things that we could do when we get back to Georgetown is to set up a meeting and to figure out how to investigate that. We are very happy to collaborate in that regard. And the point generally about that the decision around these laws will be a political one. When we were before this commission in 2013 for another thematic hearing, I remember former Commissioner Dinah Shelton saying clearly to the state party that human rights shouldn't be put to a vote and that these issues require political leadership. So it's not a political decision. They require political leadership. And Madam President just reiterated that. So what I think is needed is a firm commitment from the state that it is going to decriminalize same-sex intimacy between men in private and cross-dressing, and that in that process it will educate the population about why it is necessary for human rights protection to do that. That's the kind of leadership we need, not this kind of nonchalant, non-committal kind of attitude that, well, we're seeking the views of the population and so on, because we can't put human rights to a vote. It's not a popularity decision. I remember former Commissioner Shelton saying, well, you know, in the US, we didn't put abolishing slavery to a vote because the reality is it wouldn't have changed. And I think it's the same thing when we talk about protection of minorities in particular. We can't put them to a vote. It's the real test of a true democracy. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And I wish if it was that easy, you know, and I just had to sign. On the right to work and that amendment, we'll certainly look at that. Because as you said, the other issue is the one that's probably more divisive, if I could use that word. But I remember sitting in the National Assembly when we were passing the fundamental rights legislation, and in it was sexual orientation. And there wasn't a big publicity thing on it. And we turn up to the parliament, and in the end, with what was happening outside, that legislation had to die. Because again, of the deep, like I said, cultural and religious aspects of it. But that was about 10 years ago or 9 years ago or so, and I think we've come a far way. But I want to say that sometimes when we're trying to advocate for things, we ourselves have to be careful with our language. Because the minute you start to talk about backwardness and nonchalance and so on, you have other people that have deep feelings as well on this matter. And so it's trying to bring a convergence in a way that we both understand each other. And I said, when I say we, because there's this other section that visits my ministry ever so often to say, you're going to the OAS, if you're going there, we haven't done the work in the select committee, has not been completed, so you cannot be doing this with the resolution at the OAS when we haven't completed our work. So that's why I said it's not such a simple issue. I said it at the end of the day, it would be a political decision because we have to pass this in the National Assembly. And people take their cue from their populations. And I agree that human rights should not be put to a vote, but to decriminalize this, we have to go to a vote. That's what we have to do. And so I think that it's more how we can work together on this, Joel. How can we educate people more on this? I wouldn't like to know a brother or a cousin or a friend, you know, being discriminated against because of his sexual orientation and being locked up. And probably some of the data that you have might be important to be provided as well. Some of this data, the surveys that you have done, you know, provide some of that. And perhaps if there's some who don't believe in that, so let's just do over the survey using the same kind of thing and let's see what's happening. But it's not, I cannot make a commitment, commissioners here, that we are going to do this within this certain time. But I also want to say, Commissioner, because you, Commissioner Anton, that you did mention that human trafficking is a huge issue in Guyana. And I would not want to say it's a huge issue in Guyana. It is an issue. But to say it's a huge issue, and for me to accept that here, it means that we have tons of trafficking taking place. We've been putting quite a lot of measures in place, including with the leaders of the indigenous people's community. They are rural constables in law, and we swear them in as rural constables. So they can also arrest persons as well. We have had, and I was Minister of Indigenous Peoples Affairs for 7 years, and one of the things I was trying to get the leaders to do is when people leave the community to work, that they should probably inform the council, and they should provide that information to us, because they might be lured into work that is not, that might very well be trafficking. And there was a big pushback on that and say, it's my human rights. I don't have to tell you where I'm going and so on. So again, it has to do with a lot of education. And if I noticed you said, don't take this martial arts thing too lightly. But if that is what the National Tush House Council would like to have as well, because they're the elected leaders, then one might have to look at that. On the old-fashioned schools where people with disabilities live together and so on, I don't think we have any place where we have people living together with disabilities. But I think I agree with you that there should be a time for the training, and then they should be back into the regular. But in countries like ours, resources are also very, very scarce. And I would like to do what's probably being done in the United States of America or some other countries, yes, with good practices. But resources.
Thank you, yeah. Honorable Minister. I know that Ghana, like CARICOM, hasn't had as much familiarity with the commission as some of the other countries in that. Well, that's changing. We had, I think, 3 hearings from CARICOM this time. But part of this process is that we are able to get documentation from both the state and civil society. That is a valuable part of the whole exercise. So we really don't expect you to be able to give detailed answers to everything. It probably will be impossible. So it's an opportunity for us to bring the parties together, the state, civil society. You listen to each other in a respectful environment. But we also provide a forum to continue the dialogue. You have the country rapporteur. You have various thematic rapporteurs like myself on indigenous and so on. But to get the documentation. So we'll invite both of you to give us as much information in writing as possible, and we look forward to hearing even deeper dialogue and some action. And Madam Minister, you might be the one to provide the leadership for your colleagues. I think that's what they're trying to tell you. Okay. Thank you very much. It's the end of the hearing.